Hey, good morning, church. I am here with my associate pastor. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Hey, you guys.
He's pretty quiet, but he and I spend lots of time together these days. I may be going a little crazy.
You guys don't know the half of it.
No, we do have a great day planned for you. It's Mother's Day, so we would like to say hi to all the mothers out there watching.
Moms, we love you.
That was very nice of you, Associate Pastor. He doesn't have a mom. Anyway, we also want to let you know that we'll have another sermon on 1 Corinthians 13, Loved 13, Showing Care in the Age of Social Distancing. We will have a kids' lesson with some special guests, another kids' song, and just one video of a special song today. Not from our church, but we wanted to provide a video music option for you today. One other thing I wanted to do before we get into the rest of the service was...
Tell them about Together Again service.
I know.
Tell them about Together Again. Get to it.
Associate Pastor and I were talking about next Sunday, our Together Again Sunday. So let me show you what we have planned on the screen. This is Together Again Sunday, Leesburg Grace on the Lawn. We are going to meet next Sunday at 10:30 on the lawn. We're going to have corporate prayer and singing. We're going to have sharing and lamenting.
Lamentations.
Lamenting. Well, I'll have an associate pastor tell you about that. What does lamenting mean? What does it mean to have a time of lament?
Lamenting is crying out. It's complaining. It's telling God your disappointments, what you feel like is wrong in the world and in your life. And he likes when you're honest with him.
That is exactly right. I may be acting silly in this video.
You are.
But we have all lost something or some things during this COVID-19 era. And what we want to do is we want to make sure that we observe a time corporately where we can take those things that we have lost, write them down on a piece of paper, and we're going to toss them into a hole that we have dug outside the front of our church.
But I have no hands.
It's a way of us sharing in suffering because the church is called to do that. Grieve with those who grieve, suffer with those who suffer. And it could be something as much as I missed a dentist appointment, to I lost a vacation, to I lost I don't know how many thousands of dollars. You don't have to share what that is publicly, but we want to give you a sacred place, set aside time and place where you can write that down. And with a group of people who know you and love you, you can throw that into the grave that we have dug in front of our church. Then we'll cover it up. God wants to know our griefs and our losses, and he wants to share in the grief and loss with us. So that will be part of Together Again. Come ahead thinking of stories of God's faithfulness, but also losses that you've experienced. Well, any final words, Associate Pastor?
I miss my body.
That is what I thought. I won't tell you what he told me earlier today. Let's get on with the rest of our service.
Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be the glory, because of your love and faithfulness. Why do the nations say, where is their God? Our God is in heaven. He does whatever pleases him. The Lord remembers us and will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless those who fear the Lord, small and great alike. May the Lord make you increase, both you and your children. May you be blessed by the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The highest heavens belong to the Lord, but the earth he has given to man.
I love my mom for
it is not the dead who praise the Lord, those who go down to
if
silence.
I had to pick one,
it is we who extol the
she
Lord,
continue
both
to love
now
me
and forevermore.
Care about
praise
every single
the Lord.
And mistakes that I've made, I've made a ton.
What I love about mom is because she mostly cleans up the whole entire house and makes breakfast. I love that mom makes breakfast for us. I love this mommy food.
I love how my mom cares so much for others.
We love you. We miss you.
And what I love about mom is that she always takes care of us.
What I love about my mom is that she's amazing and she
loves me. What I like about Mom, she's funny, nice, and loving.
What I love about Mom is that she's kind, she's loving, and that she's always there. But also because she inspires me. Because she's willing to live out her faith not only at home and in her career, but in every area of her life.
What's one thing that you love about your mom?
She makes yummy food.
She's a good girl scout
for
things like this.
She's kind and generous.
She helps me.
My entire life, my mom has truly modeled what it means to love the Lord and love others. She is a prayer warrior. She's positive about everything in life.
What I love about my mom, she takes us places, gives us food, and loves us.
I love it, my mom. She makes crafts with me and goes on bike rides.
I love my mom not just because she has shown love and sacrifice to us as a family, but shows it to those all around her.
I love Mom!
I love you, Mom!
Thanks for being a great example and an amazing mother.
Thanks, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
Mom.
The universe is held within your hands, and all the earth bows down at your command. The wonder of creation will testify to all you've done. From age to age, your promises have stood. You reign as king, just like you said you would. And every generation will testify to all you've done. To all you've done. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Oh, you have done great things. You will never change. To God be the glory.
Oh, yes.
The deaf can hear, the broken live again. The blind can see, the sinner is a friend. And love's renovation will testify to all you've done.
Sing our hearts.
Our hearts. Jesus rose again, and all we'll know, your kingdom knows no end. And every tribe and nation will testify to all you've done, to all you've done.
Hi, kids. So today we're going to talk about David dancing before the Lord. But before we start, quick quiz. What is the Ark of the Covenant? Is it number one or number two? If you said number two, you're right. This is the Ark of the Covenant. And it holds things like the Ten Commandments. David and his army went to go get the Ark of the Covenant and take it to the city of David. So they put it on a new cart pulled by oxen. But on the way, one of the oxen stumbled, and Uzzah, who was guiding the cart, put out his hand to steady the ark, and he touched it. And that made the Lord angry, because no one was supposed to touch the ark. So he struck Uzzah dead. David was afraid because he saw God's anger and how he struck Uzzah dead. So he decided not to move the ark all the way to the city of David. He left it at Gath at Obed-Edom's house. It was at Obed-Edom's house for 3 months. And while it was there, the Lord blessed Obed-Edom. When David heard how Obed-Edom had been blessed by having the ark at his house, he decided to go and get it and bring it to the city of David, to a special tent that he had prepared for it. So they had a great procession, which is like a parade, to bring the Ark of the Covenant into the city of David. There was a lot of singing and music playing, and David was dancing with all his might before the Lord. Maybe his dancing looked like this. Or like this. Or even like this. Maybe he got so excited that he did flips. David offered burnt offerings and peace offerings to the Lord. He blessed all the people that were there and gave them food as gifts to take home. When David got home, his wife Michal came out to meet him. She had seen him dancing, and she was mad. Show me your mad faces. Ooh, those are scary. She was mad because she thought that David was ridiculous and shameless. But David told her that he was willing to be even more foolish and even more ridiculous in his own eyes, and even to be humiliated to obey the Lord. So how we obey God may look different than how someone else does. But that's okay. We don't have to stop obeying or be embarrassed because it's different. So this week, remember, kids, to obey God, even if you think you look silly. Bye!
Hey boys and girls, and welcome back. I have my very most special friend with me to help me sing today. We're going to sing about the foolish man and the wise man. Ready? The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up, and the house on the sand went splat. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up, and the house on the rock stood firm.
This past week, my family and I finished season number 3 of The Great British Bake Off. We have come to really like the show. Every season, the contestants become like a mini family for us. We start rooting on different people and then quietly hoping other folks get voted out of the tent. At the end of each episode, they award a star baker and then they send someone packing. The thing about The Great British Bake Off that is different than what I see in American reality TV is it's really cutthroat in American reality TV. It's competition. You want to rise to the top and you want to send people away, voting them off the island. Of course, we get that from Survivor. Well, we get to the end of season 3 of The Great British Bake Off and there are 3 contestants left. There was one I really didn't want to win, and 2, I was hoping they would make it as star baker for the season. And of course, the person who won was not the one I wanted to win, and I was having a really hard time with it. I was actually having a more difficult time when I noticed that this person got her own television series on Netflix. So we watched a little bit after she won season number 3, and we didn't like the show. And we were having a hard time with her. And the next day, I went on to Netflix and I was about to vote her show down. And then I realized I was being petty. I was trying to use this ploy to make the ratings of her show go down because I'm so competitive. That's the American way, right? You can have one winner. Everybody else is a loser. But this isn't the reality on British TV. They become family and they all put their best effort forward, and then they cheer one another on or grieve with one another as they lose. I think my wife understands this a little bit better than I do, because at the end of every episode, you look over and she has tears in her eyes when they're sending someone away. But they were so competitive. We're so competitive. And I think this is the way they were in Corinth. Right now we're doing a sermon series on 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the love chapter in Corinth, because we want to consider how do we show care in the age of social distancing. And the Apostle Paul gives us some great directions on how to do that. So we've gone through this letter so far, and one of the things that it's worth underscoring yet again is that the church in Corinth had some problems. And at the root, this was a culture that was highly competitive. They were competing with one another for honor and hoping that other people might be shamed. One author writes about it like this. He says, honor is both one's perception of one's own status and simultaneously, and more importantly, affirmation by one's peers or important others. It's the thumbs up or the thumbs down that society gives you. He goes on to say, honor thus becomes public verdict, and it is also intoxicating. This path was competitive to the core. And in Corinth, we have people who are competing for honor. I am with Paul. I am with Apollos. I have this gift. You have that gift. It was an honor race. It was competitive, it was cutthroat, and some people were gonna be voted out of the tent. Everyone wanted to be star baker in Corinth. And what the Apostle Paul is saying is more than your status, it is important that the love of God flows through you. And so in our core chapters, 12 through 14, we have the Apostle Paul talking about spiritual gifts that build up the church, and they do that best, and they do that only, really, if love is at the center. We've cited a commentator many times. Love is the mortar between the bricks of the Christian building. And so chapter 13 is letting the readers of Corinth know, what should the ethos of your church be? What should people experience and feel when they come into your church? It shouldn't necessarily be, wow, they are impressive, wow, they are gifted, wow, they are divided and fractured. No, it should be, wow, they are caring. And so we've looked at this description of love over the past few weeks. Love has positive elements. Love has negative element. I mean, love doesn't have negative elements, but there are negative elements that provide a contrast for love. So let's read this. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It doesn't rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails, is what the Apostle Paul says. And as we've looked at this, we've seen that there are 8 positive elements of love. They're actions, it's verbal. It's patient, it's kind, it rejoices with the truth, bears, believes, hopes, endures, never ends. That's positive. But there are 8 negative or contrast elements of love. What love doesn't do is envy or boast. It doesn't act arrogant or rude. And we looked at those last week in greater detail. And so what we're looking at today is that love is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. We're going to break these down and look at them in 3 different ways. But the big idea here is this. Love protects others from our pitiful ploys to destroy them, to harm them, to own them. And so we'll start with this one. Love is not irritable. Now, this word irritable shows up a few times in the New Testament, and it can be a positive term. In fact, we're encouraged as God's people to not forsake the gathering, the regular gathering with one another. Why do we get together? Well, so we can stir one another up with love and good deeds. That's our word here for irritable. It's the idea of stirring up, of provoking in a positive way. And we gather to stir one another up for love and good deeds. We've been doing that online for the past few weeks. Next week, we're going to meet on the lawn, and then we're going to slowly get back into the business of regular physical on-site gatherings. I am excited, I am prayerful, and I am hoping that when people come together, we can show care, even though we're still in the age of social distancing. So stirring up, this can be a good term, but often it's more of a negative term. The idea of inciting or provoking. This comes out in the book of Acts. Paul and Barnabas are getting ready to go on their second missionary journey. And Barnabas wants to bring along John Mark. John Mark has abandoned them on the first missionary journey. So Paul doesn't like this idea. He's not ready to clear the slate with John Mark. Later in life, he does. And this creates such a massive disagreement between these two men that they part ways. This is our word for being incited or for being irritable. It's this fight that these two have about what to do over John Mark. When the Old Testament was translated into Greek, the Hebrew scriptures translated into Greek, this word provoke is used of God in the book of Deuteronomy. Multiple times, I have 2 references up here. Israel's disobedience, Israel's idolatry and their injustice, it talks about provoking God to wrath. When we first started this discussion of love, we talked about God is patient. He is slow to anger. But it does say here in Scripture that he can be provoked to anger with enough injustice, with enough indifference, with enough idolatry. God says, I need some space from your sin. And of course, we know in the New Testament, he poured that wrath out on Jesus, who gives us a clean slate. So there's a difference between the word used in various contexts. It can mean stirring up in a positive way or provoking to wrath. We're told elsewhere, fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath. I've found out that I can be very good at pushing my kids' buttons. There are certain words that I say that are trigger words. They're hot button words. And if I just say them, I can immediately stir up some anger. I can name certain people. I can name certain subjects. And boom, provoked to anger. The interesting thing about this word in this context in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is it's not saying don't be a provoker, That would be me actively provoking other people. But the way this word incited is used is more in a passive sense. So don't be the kind of person who is easily provoked. Now, I'm not going to suggest, fathers, that you provoke your children, or husbands, you provoke your wife in a negative way, or bosses, you provoke your workers. It's not good to provoke other people and just get them riled up and frustrated. That's still not loving. But in this context, the idea is don't be the kind of person who has so many triggers, so many hot buttons, who is so easily flipped over into anger that other people feel unsettled or unsafe around you. See, in Corinth, there were lots of things that could have provoked Paul. He could have been provoked by the factions. He could have been provoked by the sexual impurity. He could have been provoked by people flaunting their freedoms. He could have been provoked by people bragging about their gifts. In the second letter, you actually see they are very disrespectful of Paul. They consider him like a baby apostle or a fake apostle, an imposter kind of apostle. And they have disrespected him. And that could have provoked him to anger. But I want to suggest that the Apostle Paul, looking at this congregation that is so riddled with problems, is choosing not to let this raise his temperature, choosing not to be provoked by their misbehavior. And so we could put this in a phrase that protecting others means reducing our hot buttons. I mean, let's be honest. Some people have the personality type where they're constantly irritated, and other people are so laissez-faire, it takes a major disruption to get them tipped over the edge. So not every one of us comes to the table with the same number of hot button issues, but each one of us can take inventory of the things that tip us over into anger, into frustration, into irritation, and we can try to pay attention to those things and try to reduce them. So protecting other means reducing our hot button issues. When I go visit my parents, they have a TV set up, and maybe it's changed since they've gone to a new system with YouTube TV, but they have a system set up where they have a TV, they have a sound system, a receiver, they have a DVD player, they have cable, and if you pick up their universal remote control, it looks something like this. There are so many different buttons, and on the top there are multiple power buttons, and when I look at that, I have no idea how to turn the machine on. I don't know if I'm turning on the DVD player, or the speaker receivers, or the television, and this kind of controller becomes a hot button issue for me. I think controllers should be simple, like this one I use to click the slides. It only has four buttons: advance, retract, the little red light here, and make the screen go black. I can handle this. This doesn't make Timmy angry. How many hot buttons do you have in your life? Are you more like this, or are you more like this? And I want to suggest that if you want to be a loving person who protects others from your rage and irritation, reduce the hot button issues in your life. And there are so many of these kind of things that can raise your blood pressure. Is politics a hot button issue with you? Well, I fear for people around you right now because we are in an election year. But we know we shouldn't talk about politics at family meals because it's a hot button issue, usually for grandpa or our aging father. Sexual identity issues. Sometimes you bring up the certain letters LGBTQ, and people at the table with you will get very frustrated, very angry. It's a hot button issue for you. Or you might be watching a television show and everything's going along fine, and all of a sudden there becomes a major theme related to the LGBTQ community. And that can be a hot button issue for you. Why does that make you so angry? You might ask yourself that question. Oh, you read something new about the environment. Did you know that this recent phase with COVID-19 and all of us being indoors a lot more has helped the environment rebuild? I think the polar bear population has replenished in the past 2 months. I don't know. But for some people, you talk about the environment or you talk about recycling, and it's a hot button issue for you. What is it about that issue that makes it such a hot button issue? How do you know it's a hot button issue? Someone brings it up and you can feel your blood boiling. Someone brings it up and you think there's a conspiracy behind it. Someone brings it up and you feel like you need to argue the opposite side of the point. These are all indications that it's a hot button issue. Economic classes. You start talking about how unfortunate things are for the poor, and you think it might be better for folks to have fairer wages. All of a sudden, you are in a hot button area. Let's raise the minimum wage for people. Hot button issue. What is it about that that it becomes a hot button issue? E-learning. You hear people talking about how they might start next year with e-learning, and you are instantly enraged. It's a hot button issue. Now, I want to suggest that some of our hot buttons aren't even issues. They could be times of day. There could be a certain time of day where you just get a little more irritable. Right after lunch, you're tired, and so you have less tolerance for things. Hot button. Maybe you need to do something different right after lunch. You might find yourself irritable at bedtime because you have little kids and they don't want to go to bed. They don't want to comply. That could be a hot button time. I had to share this because I thought this was hilarious. When our kids were really little, there was always a threat that some of their pushback from, you know, it's bedtime or bath time or whatever, some of their pushback to those things was going to flip us over the edge. And my wife devised this system where she would let them know that she was beginning to get irritable. She was in a hot button moment with the kids. And she would say, children, I am turning the color yellow right now. You don't want me to turn the color orange. And when I turn red, you will want to flee for your lives. Sometimes my girls, when they were really little, they would notice their mommy getting irritable. Yes, it's Mother's Day, so let's talk about moms. Moms sometimes get irritable, and they do because they love their children and they want the best for them. And sometimes their children make that difficult. So children behave today. So sometimes my girls, when they were little, they'd go, Mommy, are you, what color are you right now? Are you turning yellow? Because they would sense that she was being irritable. Protecting other people means reducing your hot buttons. And so it's worth taking some time to figure out, what are the hot buttons? What controller do you look more like? And what is it that makes these issues so frustrating for you? And then how can you avoid them, or how can you mature through them? That's the question that Paul wants his readers to wrestle with as they become more loving. He also says that love is not resentful. What does this mean, that love is not resentful? Well, this word is a reasoning term. It could be used to talk about how we should meditate on things that are good. It actually ties in with the word we use, logic. It's the verbal form to logically think through something. Paul says later in this very same chapter that he used to reason like a child, but he wants to reason like an adult. Of course, this word has another form that shows up more often when Paul and others use it, and it's the form of accounting. And so this accounting term might mean that Jesus, when he was on the cross, if you looked to the right and you looked to the left, you could count him among sinners. Or Paul says that he doesn't count his whole old life and all of his successes as a Jewish person, circumcised on the eighth day, born in the right tribe, trained as a Pharisee. He doesn't count those old wins as a reason to pat himself on the back. What he's pursuing is Jesus. God counts Abram as righteous. This is a really important passage from the Old Testament, Genesis chapter 15, verse 6, where we know in the Old Testament that God doesn't deal with his people just based upon law and their obedience to it, but based upon faith. That's always the way that God has dealt with his people. And when he sees them living a life of faith, trusting them, being loyal to him. When God sees that in his people like Abraham, he says, you are righteous. This gets quoted often by Paul in Romans 4:3 and Galatians 3:6. And when God sees our faith and our faithfulness, he counts that as righteousness. God doesn't count our old sins against us. This is a really powerful verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Instead, what he does, instead of counting our sin against us, he sees Jesus' righteousness and he says, that's the account you have. You get Jesus' positive account, not your negative account. And so this term shows up in a lot of different ways in the New Testament or translated from the Old Testament. It's a reasoning term and it's an accounting term. And we recognize in Corinthians that the people there had this system of counting up honorable deeds or honor status symbols. I already read this quote, but I've extended it a little bit here. McKnight says in his book, this path of honor was competitive to the core, and once there, one marked one's status in what one wore, in one's occupation, and where one sat at public events and banquets, and how one got along in the legal system. In other words, what happened in Corinth is that everybody had a slate that they would carry around. And in this slate, you might have a name, and that name would give you status. You might have a particular job, and that gave you status. You might make a certain amount of money, status. You might make a, you might have a certain trade that was more honorable, status. You might wear certain kind of clothes, status. And each person walked around with these status markers. And if someone else called that into question or beat you in an honor contest, you might actually lose some status. And so in Corinth, this idea of the tabs that we have, this accounting that we do of ourselves and others, was a very real issue. And what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13 is he says, don't keep tabs of other people's wrongs. And so you don't want to keep a record of all the things that people do so that you can kind of knock them down status-wise or keep them at a distance relationship-wise. This is what's going on in Corinth. Again, love is supposed to be something that protects other people. So protecting others means refreshing our tabs. Because the reality is this. Not only do you keep a tab of your own honor or good deeds or gifts, check, 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 but we walk around with a mental tab of other people's misdeeds or other people's virtues, and we keep these lists in our heads too. And what the Apostle Paul is saying is be careful of walking around with this list that other people, where they have failed, where they have hurt you, where they have disappointed you, where they have not met your expectations. What he says is, we need to refresh that tab. Give people a clean slate. Let them start over. Here's the thing. If you are keeping tallies on other people, well, they said that mean thing to me. Well, they never paid me back when they owed me money. Well, they were late for the seventh time in a row. Well, they invited other people over, but not me. Well, they used nasty language. Well, they dressed like a slob. If you keep this kind of tally on other people, then you can use it to retaliate against them. You can use this kind of stuff to hurt people in relationships. Love doesn't want to do that. So protecting others means refreshing our tabs, those tabs that we keep for others. And this can come in a variety of ways that we might keep tabs on other people. We might be trying to balance the scales with other people. I mean, I got a silly example of this from recently. And this could be good things that you do that you hold over other people, or good things others do and you feel indebted. And this becomes a tab that you carry around. So about 4 weeks ago, I invited Dan Porter to come up to the church and eat with me, and we got Stacy's, and we got meatloaf. And I think Dan felt really indebted to me, because just 2 weeks later, he called me up, and he invited me and my wife to sit on the lawn with him and his wife, and they bought us cerulean. So let me ask you the question, if we're talking about balancing the scales. Tim and Dan eat meatloaf? The porters buy the sprinkle cerulean. Who do you think's winning on that scale right there? Now, I know that. That's in my head. And there's part of me that thinks like, oh, I got to take Dan out for tacos again. Or we need to get the porters a gift. Maybe you're not so petty and you don't think in those terms. But I think sometimes we keep a tab of what we owe people or what people owe us. And so we always try to balance the scales. I don't want to be indebted to someone else. Now, maybe a more negative way that this shows up in refreshing our tabs is that we have this way of unearthing the past. So we had a past conflict with a spouse, and there was that one time that we called our spouse the name that should not be mentioned. And it was a long time ago, and we have apologized. And since then, the spouse says, "So are you going to call me that again?" That is unearthing the past. It might not be a one-time event. It could be a pattern of behavior that you draw up. Maybe you had a pattern of behavior of never calling and never making plans. And you just sort of show up and no one knows what to expect. And since then, you've amended your ways and you've gotten better at sharing your plans and trying to be a little bit more timely with sharing those kind of things. But they hold it over you. Oh, you're going to be late again? You're just going to show up again? This could be an example of unearthing the past. Sometimes when we have these patterns of behavior, or when we have these things stuck in our mind, that one thing that someone did or said, we can hold on to that bitterness, because that bitterness gives us a feeling of power. There was someone who had promised to pay us back, and they told us like three times over the course of 3 weeks they were going to pay us back. And you have since given up on the fact that they're going to pay you back. And you kind of like the fact that they're not going to pay you back, because now it gives you a little bit of power over them and you hold on to that. It gives you something to hold over them. What we got to do in those moments is we have to refresh the tab. We have to provide a clean slate. Don't tally that against them. The other thing we can do is we can withhold forgiveness from people. Withholding forgiveness from people is a way of keeping tabs of wrongs that they have done. And so something you might do, something you might hold against someone. There was a moment in your life where someone damaged something that you let them borrow. And when they gave it back to you, they didn't tell you that they damaged that thing. They were hoping that you wouldn't notice. And to be honest, you actually didn't notice for a little while. And then later you discovered like, oh man, this thing's like, oh, it's not working. Maybe it was water damaged. Maybe it was dented. It doesn't matter how it was damaged. The fact that they didn't let you know, and then you discovered it, and then when you confronted them about it, they actually were kind of in denial about it. Now you have a major trust issue with this person. And you've had plenty of good moments with them since then, but that one thing, it's like, I'm not going to trust this person. This person's a liar. Now, that would be an example where you're not going to give them or grant them forgiveness. You're holding that against them and saying, this person cannot be trusted anymore with a truth or with my stuff. I want to suggest that forgiving doesn't mean that you forget everything. That's impossible to do. Our memories store these kind of things. And every time you look at that dent, you're probably going to remember, or look at that water damage, you're probably going to remember, oh yeah, this person wrecked my thing. And it's going to bring that memory back up. But withholding forgiveness is just never letting that person know, hey, I know that you messed my stuff up. I forgive you for that. And we can make the choice to do that. Now, it doesn't mean that you're necessarily going to let them borrow your car the next day or give them your favorite device to use, your laptop or something like that. But withholding forgiveness can be a way that we don't refresh our tabs. The Apostle Paul is saying, if you love people, you're going to refresh the tab. There are new mercies that God extends to us every day. It says that in Lamentations. Every day there are new mercies. If God, who knows all of our sins, all of our errors, all of our selfishness, if he knows all of that and still extends us new mercies every day, we should be willing to offer forgiveness to people, to let go of bitterness, to keep the past in the past, and not constantly try to balance the scales with people. Love refreshes the tabs. And so it's important for us to extend new mercies. We have one more part in this passage, and it's 1 Corinthians 13:16. And what Paul's going to do here is he's going to put together a positive and he's going to put together a negative. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. The word for rejoice here is slightly different in the blue. It's rejoicing with others. This one is just rejoicing. But I think what it does is it gives you this idea that your joy is meant to be shared. And so there might be a verbal idea in the joy here. Love does not rejoice at wrongdoing. That word wrongdoing is translated lots of different ways depending on your Bible. Wrongdoing in the ESV, it could be translated evil. It doesn't rejoice in evil. It doesn't rejoice in injustice. Iniquity, that's the King James. It rejoiceth not in iniquity. Or the NASB just generally is unrighteousness. I like this translation, unrighteousness, because you see it used elsewhere using this very same word. But wrongdoing is not something that God can be accused of. It says that clearly in Romans 9:16. Wrongdoing is often contrasted with the truth. Jesus said the truth will set us free. There is a true and right and beautiful way of living that God lays out in the scriptures. And then there is the unrighteous way. The good news is that we can be cleansed from all unrighteousness if we ask. Remember, God clears the slates for us. He gives us new mercies. And we can be cleansed from unrighteousness. And others who confess their sins can be cleansed from unrighteousness. So instead of rejoicing in all the things that are wrong, talking about it, gossiping about it, focusing on it, we should spend more time talking about the things that are good, celebrating the things that are noble, and make that our focus. See, if our love is protecting others, it means we're rejecting gossip and we're reporting on the good news. And you all know that there's been rarely a conversation in the past 6 to 8 weeks that hasn't eventually, or for the most part, talked about COVID-19. And it's easy to get caught up in conspiracy theories, caught up in the difficulty, the frustration, the fear, and everything that's going on in society related to it. But the Apostle Paul is saying that we should reject gossip and report good news. That's what love does. It doesn't just focus verbally on the negative. And so some ways that we might be avoiding gossip. The bad news is this, the daily death rates. Are you talking about that constantly? The monthly unemployment numbers, 20 billion or something like, 20 million in the States in April. Police reports. Are you the kind of person who reads those and you like to find out that people are getting caught? Now, there's a healthy sense of justice, but there's also this perverted sense of, I want to know people are getting caught. I want to see what they did wrong. Political scandal. Do you like it when news surfaces of a politician and one of the northeastern states that said something really irate and got caught for it? Yeah, political scandal. I think that one of the things that might be a sign that you are rejoicing in wrongdoing is if you hear that, man, people are locked down in the cities and New York has been hit hard. And there are some people probably even in our church who are like, well, that serves them right in the city. That serves them right in New York. They're so arrogant there. They think they have everything figured out. This will show them that they don't have control or they're not. If you have thought anything like that, you might be the kind of person who rejoices in wrongdoing. You might be the person who delights in gossip. You got to pay attention to that kind of stuff when it comes out of your mouth or when it's stirring in your heart. It could be church conflict. you might have news that there was a church that was meeting during quarantine, and you don't think that was right, but then you found out that they had police officers come and make sure that they scattered and went home, and you kind of delighted in that, and you were telling other people about that. That could be a sign that you are the kind of person who delights, rejoices in wrongdoing, especially when you start telling other people, did you hear the news that? Anytime you tell a story, did you hear the news that? And then share gossip. That's not loving. It's not protecting people from gossip. You might like to share stories of breakup. You might like to share stories of meltdown that people had. Oh, did you know so-and-so finally cracked? Oh, they were so full of themselves and finally they broke down. If you share those stories, you might be the kind of person who rejoices in wrongdoing. And the Apostle Paul says we shouldn't be that kind of person. We shouldn't delight in other people's suffering. We shouldn't delight in other people's wrongdoing. We shouldn't share those stories. In Corinth, there was news of a man with his mother-in-law, and the people were bragging about it. In Corinth, there were people flaunting their rights, and Paul says, enough with that. Because love doesn't rejoice in wrongdoing. Love doesn't gossip. It rejects gossip. I have really found a lot of just enjoyment in watching Some Good News, hosted by John Krasinski on YouTube. Each week, he's taken 10 to 15 minutes to share stories that people are sending in on their phones of good news during this time of social distancing. And it's been really, really uplifting to watch. Again, it's like the end of the Great British Bake Off. I look over and my wife's teared up and I'm teared up and the kids are like, why do you cry so much? Some good news. I was in the car this week and I was listening to an interview from the guy who runs the zoo in Fort Wayne. And he was saying, one of the things that's so hard for me is knowing that we want to keep people safe, but we can't share our animals. So we're going to follow all the procedures and hopefully get some people to come into the zoo. But I love my job because I love that I get to share the animals with our community. That's good news when you get to share these beautiful creatures that are wandering about. He goes, that's what a zoo's about. It's about sharing all the variety of biological life. That's some good news. I loved listening to that guy talk about it. Just him talking about how much joy he had in his job made me happy. I'm like, I gotta renew my zoo membership, even if I can't go this week. Because love relishes in good news. See, protecting others means we reject gossip and we relish in good news. It means we refresh our tabs. We're not holding people's wrongs against them or trying to balance the scales so we owe people or they owe us. It means that we are reducing the hot button issues in our lives so that we're not so irritable. Because we want to be the people who protect others from our pitiful ploys to own them, to hurt them, to destroy them. And maybe this language feels too strong for you. You are not pitiful in your ploys, and you are definitely not trying to own someone else. I want to suggest that there's something in our broken human nature that does feel like we need to protect our own, and if we can, we'll try to own you too. And I learned this from a game called The Fist. And without giving them any other instruction than what you're about to see, I had my daughters play the game The Fist. And I think this game reveals something about human nature. Let's watch. Let's say hi to Claire and Margo. Hi, Claire and Margo.
Hi.
Thanks for participating in this game called Fist. Here's how this works. Claire has in her hand a green piece of foam, and Margo is going to try to get that from Claire, and she has 30 seconds. On your mark.
Can we get ready?
Get set, go. Time's up. Okay. And now it's Margo's turn. Reverse roles. Margo has this. The game is Fist. You have 30 seconds. Let's reset the clock to get that from your sister Claire. Go. You won! Margo, did you ever think that you could ask Claire to hand it to you? Claire, did you ever think that you could ask Margot to hand it to you?
No.
So here's what happens in the game The Fist. You ask someone to get an object from another person. You don't ask the other person to hold the other object in a clenched fist, although the game is called The Fist, so maybe it implies that. You don't give any other rules. You don't say you can't use words. You just say, get the other object. And pretty much every time people play this game without knowing that you could just ask for the item, they start grabbing and the other person keeps clinging to it. Because there is something in our human nature that says, I need to own it. I need to own it. This is what we learn from the game The Fist. See, one of the things that we should own is that we all have hot buttons. What are the things that make you so irritable? Who are the people you feel most irritable around? What are the times of day or places that you go where your hot button is getting hotter? Where you're getting to a level orange and a red. What are they? You need to own them, or they'll own you. You need to own them so you can give them over to God. What are your tabs that you're keeping with people? You might have a tab that says, so-and-so owes me, so-and-so hurt me, so-and-so can't get close to me because of this thing in the past. Or your tab might be something more like, I gave this, I did that, and so these folks are indebted to me. Own your tabs. And then own your gossip. Right now, we're spending a lot of the same time with the same people, and it's really easy to talk about other folks that we see on TV, other folks that we see online, other folks that we know are suffering, and they are image bearers just like you and me. We need to own our gossip and know that love doesn't talk negatively about other people. So own that. We need to own up to our ploys, because gossip is a way of hurting other people. Keeping tabs is a way of hurting other people. Having hot buttons so people don't feel safe around you hurts other people. We all have these pitiful ploys. And love protects others from our pitiful ploys. Our pitiful ploy to own them. And we need to recognize actually that we're owned. This is a theological truth that should reshape the way that we view other people and ourselves. The Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians to his readers, the reason that you don't practice sexual immorality, the reason that you have healthy relationships with other people, is because you are under God's care. You are owned by God, and he has asked us to live in a loving way. Don't you know that your body's a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. You are not your own, because you are owned by God. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit delight in you. They won't gossip about you. They're not going to try to provoke you to anger. And by Jesus's work on the cross, you have a clean tab. When you are owned by God, that's good news. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your love for us, a cleansing love, a perfect love, a slow to anger kind of love. A love that should be imitated by us in our most important relationships at home, in our regular relationships at work and in the neighborhood, and even in our distant relationships as we go in grocery stores or connect with people virtually online. You want us to love, and to love well, and to love in a way where we're not irritated, and to love in a way where we're not begrudging and keeping tabs, and to love in such a way where we speak well of others. So help us own those areas in our lives that are pitiful, and help us rest in the fact that we are owned by you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.